Hi, I'm Bruce Goldstein. I'm discussing technology transfer, and in this segment I'll be talking about the different forms of intellectual property. In the United States, there are actually quite a few different types of intellectual property, but I'm going to be discussing the four major ones. The first are patents, second copyrights, trademarks, and finally trade secrets. Now, what are the differences? So a patent, it protects new embodiments of useful ideas, plants, and designs. And they last for roughly 20 years from the earliest filing date. Now, there are a lot of procedural rules to set an actual expiration date, but that's a topic that can take an entire semester. Copyrights. Copyrights protect what are known as original works of authorship that are embodied in a tangible medium of expression. It's a very dense sentence. I will be breaking that apart and explaining it. But you'll notice the term is normally the life of the author plus 70 years. So you'd think, why is it that long? Well, there are good reasons why it lasts that long. The biggest being, well, if you tell somebody go invent something, it's really difficult to do. If you tell somebody go write your own book, it's much more feasible, and it's the scope of protection is much narrower. You're only protecting against people copying your book. So it's there's a reason why it is that long a term. Trademarks protect marks that identify the source of goods and services that are in the stream of commerce. And they last for as long as the mark is used in commerce. So for those of you who are fans of beer, Bass Ale claims to have the longest continuous use trademark of about 400 years. I've never looked that up to verify it, and I don't know if it's true, but it gives you an idea of how long a trademark can last. It is as long as it is used in commerce. Finally, there are trade secrets, and these are the disfavored form of intellectual property. I'll get to them briefly, but what they protect is commercially valuable and protected information, and they last for, well, as long as the information remains secret and valuable. Ben Franklin is credited with saying in Poor Richard's Almanac, three can keep a secret if two of them are dead. So take that for what it's worth. So why do we have these? Particularly in the United States, we're all about free and open competition. We don't like monopolies or other unfair balances. Well, we actually do have a good reason for giving a measure of exclusivity in these instances. For patents and copyrights, this is actually in the United States Constitution. It's that important. The founders of our country realized how crucial patents are to a strong and vibrant economy. But the core function of both patents and copyrights, but particularly patents, we have hundreds of years of experience knowing that if you don't have patents and copyrights, people keep their stuff secret. And they do so to give themselves that competitive advantage so that their others can't use it. But if you give the creator the promise that says you will have a period of time in which to try and get value for your creation, you can safely tell the world about it. And that's the trade-off. We also do it as a kind of reward to the creator over one who merely copies. Just to pick on them because they're an easy target, Walmart. Walmart brings economies of scale, marketing, cheap labor, and other things to bring down prices for consumers. Well, that's a social good, perhaps, but not nearly as much of a social good as creating the thing in the first place. And so we at least want to give the inventor or the author the first crack at making a profit. And finally, and this is by far the most debated, is that as the founders believed, and as many economic papers have shown in the years since, if you have a strong patent and copyright system, your economy tends to grow faster. Now, that is debatable because there are also economic studies that say the reverse, and I'm not trying to settle that debate and saying there is only one true answer. But that is one of the major policy bases why we have exclusivity. For trademarks, it's a very different thing. Trademarks are there to help the marketplace figure out who is selling what. And it's, you can think of it as an alternative form of consumer protection, to make sure you don't have copycat products pretending to be something that they're not. Finally, trade secrets. The point of trade secret protection is basically to stop people from behaving badly in the commercial sandbox. It's considered not a fair thing for your senior vice president to take the secrets of your company and turn around and form a competition that uses your secrets. Society doesn't benefit from your having the secret, but they do benefit from people behaving well in the marketplace. So if you can prove that you have a secret and you can prove that somebody took it, an actual theft, if you will, then you can get some measure of protection. Now, what about owning data? I hear that a lot, particularly as scientists transition to working with the tech transfer offices, and in some cases transition to working in a tech transfer office. I also hear that from lawyers and tech transfer people who understand a nuance to this phrase. In reality, you can't own data in its purest sense, because to own a thing means you have the raw power to keep others away from that information, either through a physical barrier, secret stash, or you can walk into a court and say, I have a right to this piece of information. And the court will say, yeah, you do have a right, and we're going to stop others from utilizing your information. But if you don't have one of these three things, once data becomes publicly known, there is no power on earth you can actually grant exclusivity. You can't get a court to say, take that data out of your brain and give it back. You can't prove where somebody got that data. It's out there. It's gone. So as a metaphysical matter, you cannot own data. What you're saying when you own data is you own the patents, the copyrights, and the trade secrets that embody that information. But that's all you can get. Well, I hope you found this useful. Thank you for listening. And if you have any questions, please contact the program coordinator.